Major funding for war and peace in the nuclear age was provided by the Annenberg CPB Project. Additional funding was provided by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies for over 100 years, providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. And by the W. Walton Jones Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, public television stations, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
An army of reporters has come to the pine woods of East Texas to see what the world has never seen before. The destruction of an American nuclear missile. Not an obsolete missile, but a Pershing II from the front lines of the U.S. arsenal in Europe. It could have killed millions of Russians. On the plains of Kapustin Yar in the Soviet Union, the Russians are preparing to blow up SS-20 missiles, capable of devastating a substantial piece of Western Europe. For the first time in the nuclear age, up-to-date missiles are being taken out of the equation of fear.
President of the United States and the General Secretary of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union.
Washington, December 1987. With a few strokes of their pens, Reagan and Gorbachev got rid of two entire classes of nuclear missiles aimed at Europe. The audience and the world applauded. Yet only 4 years before, both superpowers had been insisting that these very missiles were vital to their defense. Now they were saying they were not needed. What caused this extraordinary turnaround? This is the story of the long and torturous drama leading up to Europe's zero hour. By the mid-1970s, when this story starts, there were 7,000 American nuclear battlefield weapons in Europe. Their purpose was to deter Soviet conventional forces from ever attacking here, on the Central Front in West Germany. They were also a demonstration of America's commitment to use nuclear forces, battlefield and strategic, in the defense of Europe. Troops stationed here trained for a nuclear battle.
You perceive the brilliant flash of light, and you start counting. 1-1,000, 2-1,000, 3-1,000, and you estimate the time that it takes for the bang to reach your location. That is flash-to-bang time. Question.
Most persons would be trying to find cover, so how realistic is to think that someone, when they see the fireball, they're going to begin counting?
Well, real-world problem, granted. But how do we compensate and hope that somebody does it? We train people to do it. No guarantee they're going to do it when the actual situation occurs. But we at least try to reinforce the training to condition them to do it.
But military problems aside, by the mid-70s, the Europeans doubted American political resolve to fight a nuclear war on their behalf.
Could you trust the American commitment to use nuclear weapons if the Soviets attacked Europe? That was the issue.
Leonid Brezhnev and his colleagues had built up the nuclear forces of the Soviet Union to match those of the United States. Arms agreements now allowed each superpower to have roughly equal numbers of missiles aimed at each other, but they did not limit the numbers aimed at Western Europe. And here, the balance of firepower was about to change. In 1974, the Soviets introduced a new missile. The new SS-20 was three generations ahead of its 50s predecessors. Mobile, solid-fueled, with three warheads, it was very accurate. For the Soviet military, facing enemies in Europe and Asia, it was a welcome addition.
I am being offered such a magnificent missile. It is maneuverable. I can move it here or there at will. So the factors of military technology were the most important here. Nobody planned it specifically, the installation of the SS-20. A new missile appeared. We had the SS-4 and others for a long time. Why not put in the new missile? I offer that no one weighed the political and military consequences.
Whether intended or not, those consequences were to be enormous. For the SS-20 missile seriously alarmed the major political leader in Western Europe, Helmut Schmidt of West Germany.
When I got the first informations that the development of the SS-20 missiles was complete, that they had started to produce them, that they even had started to deploy them or were about to start deployment, I got the feeling that the equilibrium was going to be toppled.
Schmidt was convinced that the SS-20 upset the nuclear balance in Europe and posed a special threat to West Germany. Now that there was parity between the superpowers, he wondered if the United States was ever likely to use its strategic forces to counter the SS-20. That is, to risk Chicago for Hamburg. Germany would be vulnerable to nuclear blackmail. Schmidt took these worries to Washington in July 1977, but his task was complicated by a poor personal rapport with the new president.
When Schmidt arrived at the White House for the public ceremony, Carter went almost into raptures that he had, as a lowly governor of Georgia, been permitted when he visited Germany to be entertained by the chancellor himself. And Carter had the highest regard for Schmidt, which Schmidt, if he had been more astute about Germany's interests, would have been willing to exploit. But he took, in part, a dislike to Carter.
The problem wasn't just poor personal chemistry. Schmidt wanted Carter to include the SS-20 in SALT II, the strategic arms talks then underway with the Soviets. The Americans disagreed. They argued the SS-20 wasn't a strategic missile, didn't belong in SALT II, and wasn't much of a threat to Germany.
They had the peculiar habit of calling strategic only such weapons which could hit their own soil and their own cities. And I said to them, well, the first one little so-called battlefield nuclear which hits people on German soil for the German nation is a strategic event.
The fact is that the Soviets have had a monopoly of intermediate range nuclear weapons since the 1950s, and that we were unconcerned about it because we believed that the overall capabilities of U.S. forces were sufficient to offset any localized monopoly.
They posed a threat to which we could respond adequately with existing forces.
Changed strategic conditions have confronted us with new problems.
Schmidt failed in Washington, but he was not a man to be deflected. In a speech in London, he publicly expressed his fears that European interests were being ignored.
But strategic arms limitation, confined to the United States and the Soviet Union, would be bound to impair the security of the West European members of the alliance vis-a-vis Soviet military superiority in Europe if we did not succeed in removing the disparities in Europe parallel to the SALT negotiations.
Schmidt's language was careful, but this expert audience knew who he was talking about.
There was a dinner afterwards. I was much more clearer at that dinner, even somewhat insulting as regards the American hesitance. And from that dinner on, I think, a process of rethinking started in Washington.
Well, the Schmidt speech hit us like a thunderbolt. It really shocked and unsettled the whole Carter administration. The feeling was that the German chancellor was challenging President Carter on Soviet-American relations and on arms control, and that he was saying either do something militarily to meet the new threat from the Soviet SS-20 missiles, or come up with an arms control proposal for eliminating that threat.
Carter might never have responded to this challenge had it not been for another nuclear dispute which now flared up between him and Schmidt over press reports of the Pentagon's plans to build a neutron bomb. The minor issue had a decisive effect on American policy. The neutron bomb was the U.S. Army's answer to one of NATO's oldest dilemmas: how to use nuclear weapons to stop Soviet tanks if they swept through Germany without at the same time destroying Germany and its people. The neutron bomb was a small hydrogen device fired by an artillery shell or missile. It was designed to hit Russian tanks with massive doses of radiation while sparing Germany's towns from the blast and fallout. Fine in theory, except some thought it would make nuclear weapons easier to use. It touched off an immediate chord of protest, which caught the politicians off balance.
Thank you.
President Carter had his doubts about all nuclear weapons. He had not initiated the neutron project, but now he had to take the heat for it.
Production of a weapon of this nature, which would seem to prioritize property over the preservation of human life.
I have not yet decided whether to produce the neutron bomb or to deploy it among our armed forces in Europe and other places. I'll make that decision before this summer is over.
Carter's advisors did not share his doubts about the neutron bomb. While he was making up his mind about the weapon, they set about persuading the Europeans to take it.
Our view was that it had to be deployed. Now, since it is primarily an anti-tank weapon, it didn't make much sense deploying it in Portugal or in Great Britain. The place where it had to be deployed was on the Central Front. Now, the Central Front means Germany. So the real question was, would the Germans permit us to deploy it?
I was opposed to that. After some time of discussion, I was willing to give in. For what reasons? For the reasons that I didn't wish to fight two or three fights at one time with my most important ally, the United States of America.
Schmidt's reluctance was understandable. Many Germans feared that the neutron bomb would turn their country into a nuclear battlefield. His own party was violently opposed to it.
You know, it was a difficult debate in the country. It was a difficult debate in Parliament and in our Social Democratic Party. But the cabinet came to a decision to accept deployment.
So Carter's staff was able to report to the president that the Germans had been persuaded to take the neutron bomb.
It then surfaced, at least to me, in my own mind, that the president really didn't want that weapon, period. And that he had hoped it would go away. He had hoped, it all of a sudden became clear to me, that basically the Europeans would not bite the bullet on deployment, and therefore he wouldn't have to produce. And he was rather disturbed when we told him.
Carter finally made up his mind not to produce the neutron bomb. A messenger took the news to Europe. Schmidt was not pleased to be left in the lurch.
Not only had he lost his face vis-a-vis a lot of people, also had he made me lose my face, which I have not forgotten.
What that did was to shake profoundly European confidence in us. It made it look as if we had the nuclear allergy. We were afraid of these weapons, which only reinforced European fears of nuclear weapons. It made us look as if we were irresolute, unpredictable, at a time when it was even more important to Europeans to feel a steady American lead.
To trust in the American nuclear guarantee, European leaders have to believe that the Americans know what they're doing. After the neutron affair, they weren't so sure. Jimmy Carter visited Europe in 1978. In public, all was friendship and trust, but the Americans knew that they had to reassert their nuclear leadership of the alliance, and the obvious way to do that was with hardware. NATO had not had land-based missiles capable of hitting the Soviet Union since the unsatisfactory Jupiter was withdrawn in the 1960s. But now, many in the military wanted missiles of that range brought back in, not just to counter the SS-20, but to make sure that any conflict in Germany would automatically spread to the Soviet Union.
The new deployment was looking for systems which could strike the Soviet Union. Not necessarily all the way to Moscow, but some of the capabilities to Moscow in order to put at risk those things the Soviets value so that deterrence would work and they wouldn't be interested in trying to influence or intimidate Western Europeans.
One option was obvious. The revolutionary cruise missile had an engine light enough to carry and a sophisticated guidance system which could take a warhead under enemy radar far into the Soviet Union. The manufacturers claimed that it was a wonder weapon.
The exciting thing to me is that you have literally a 1,000-mile airplane in a 14-foot box that's infinitely obedient. You could literally program it to spell Pepsi-Cola.
Now, what about the bang that it carries? What effect would a bang like that have on the city of London?
Well, could ruin somebody's entire day.
As missiles go, cruise was cheap, $1 million a warhead, and it was easy to install in any NATO country. But the military planners were reluctant to put all their eggs in one basket. So they also gave the go-ahead to modernize and extend the range of the Pershing 1 missile already based in Germany.
Pershing 2 has an increased range of up to 1,800 kilometers with an order of magnitude improvement in accuracy.
Pershing 2 could reach the Soviet Union in 8 minutes. It had a very accurate targeting system.
Live radar video is compared with a stored video reference of the terrain features surrounding the target area. Position errors are transmitted to the inertial guidance system that steers the missile to the target with pinpoint accuracy.
In January 1979, at a summit meeting on the French island of Guadeloupe, Carter offered this package of weapons to his European allies. The roles were now reversed. The Americans eager to deploy the weapons, the Europeans sensing political problems at home more hesitant.
Carter was saying to us, look, I'm ready to build these weapons, but I'm not ready to build them and waste the taxpayers' money on them, and there's some of you who are willing to deploy them.
This is where Helmut got a little uptight. And he said, well, I don't think I want them on German soil unless others take them. I pointed out, look, we've already got American bases. We have the strategic bases and we have the F-111s in our country. So really, you're not taking on any greater risk. And Schmidt acknowledged that this was so. But at the end of a rather ill-natured discussion, I'm bound to say, he did agree that Germany in the end would have to take them, provided others did.
I wasn't very happy about it in the first place. But in the second place, Jim Callahan said, well, this might in the end be necessary, but let us negotiate with the Russians first in order to remove their SS-20s. And Giscard said, well, this is a good idea, but if they do not know from the beginning on that in the end we would deploy missiles on our side as well, then the negotiations will fail. So let us give them a defined period of time after which we would deploy. If not, in between we have come to an agreement.
Thus was born the double-track policy which NATO formally adopted in December 1979. It threatened to deploy Cruz and Pershing unless the Soviets agreed to take out their SS-20s. This dual-track approach was designed to placate Western public opinion. No one thought through how it would work. The first test of public response came in Britain. Late in 1980, residents of two country villages learned that cruise missiles would be stationed in their neighborhood. The Minister of Defense arrived to explain the decision. It was over a decade since any British politician had last had to sell nuclear weapons to the public.
If no good shouting rubbish at the facts, if you won't meet.
He answered the question, he couldn't answer, he wasn't capable of answering.
The point is that cruise missiles are not wanted by the country.
I think anger is understandable when you get a shallow, platitudinous performance from the Secretary of State on the platform.
Suddenly, nuclear war and its effects were back on the public agenda and on the television screens.
At enormous pressures and with winds up to 2,000 miles an hour, the blast wave spreads outwards, following the heat flash as thunder follows lightning.
Once again, the media were asking awkward questions about civil defense. With selected leaders safe in their bunkers, what would happen to the population as a whole?
The government have in fact produced a booklet which explains these matters in some detail. It's called Protect and Survive.
The government solemnly attempted to reassure the public by telling them how to build their own shelters at home. The result was only to heighten public worries about nuclear war. The British anti-nuclear movement, forgotten since the 1960s, now began to grow fast.
The whole cruise missile decision was taken without any debate in Parliament at all. It was just imposed on the British people. They just rolled the media over them.
We felt responsible for our children's lives and future.
I think it's quite arrogant of them to assume that we don't care enough to protest about it.
I had this sense that the British people only really think about matters of political principle once every 30 years or so, and you actually hear the creaking, you know, of the rusty cogs as they're going round. You want to put some oil on them. But when they do, there is an extremely exciting sense of freshness around.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute...
But by now, there was a new president in America who saw these issues very differently. The incoming president expanded the defense budget and in speech after speech, bitterly attacked the Soviet Union.
So far, détente's been a one-way street that the Soviet Union has used to pursue its own aims. Soviet aggression and support for violence around the world have eroded the confidence needed for arms negotiations.
They are the focus of evil in the modern world.
The missiles NATO was due to deploy were now being produced, but President Reagan's rhetoric was making it harder for European governments to sell them to their people.
The American president declared that the policy of detente is dead, that Russia is a reign of evil. That means suddenly the double track, which was regarded by my own party members as a progressive decision, not to deploy at once, but to wait for some years to see whether there might be results of negotiations, was reduced to a new arms race.
To the left wing in Germany, it was an arms race now being driven by the irresponsible nuclear cowboy in the White House. Weapons once intended to prove Jimmy Carter's toughness were now seen as part of an American plan to turn Germany into a nuclear battleground.
They are there for first strike capacity, capability, and we feel that we have enough already on overkill in Europe, enough land, not land, but sea and air-based systems to combat any threat.
I'm a pastor of a Protestant church, and I fear that one day this country where I live in will be a target for a big atomic holocaust.
America is putting here atomic weapons and every all their shit here into our country, and we don't want it, you know.
In Brussels, the marchers assemble. Six or 7,000 may not be many as demonstrations go, but what matters is that they came from all over Europe.
In the autumn of 1981, millions of West Europeans took to the streets to oppose the weapons of both superpowers and became actors in the unfolding drama. Many in the peace movement wanted Europe to become a third voice between the superpowers, a non-nuclear haven. More immediately, they wanted to stop NATO from deploying Cruise and Pershing.
We have succeeded in generating an international movement, but we've not yet stopped one missile. That is our task next year. The whole grotesque carnival of war goes on.
The scale of the peace movement changed the political game. When Helmut Schmidt welcomed an ailing Leonid Brezhnev to Bonn in late 1981, he knew that his own Social Democratic Party was turning against the dual-track decision. Struggling to keep the negotiating track open, Schmidt tackled Brezhnev about the SS-20 missile.
I was showing him the German cities that his generals were about to destroy with their SS-20s. And he showed me the Russian military charts, how far the American ground-launched cruise missiles and how far the Pershing 2s and their evaluation would reach into Russian territory.
But Schmidt's pleas fell on deaf ears. The Soviets were beginning to realize that divisions in Western Europe might prevent cruise and Pershing from ever being deployed.
They really thought that they could destroy the double track, that they could stop deployment, and that they could by this means create a real Western NATO crisis.
It wasn't yet a crisis, but a tide of anti-American feeling was sweeping through Europe. Leaders like Schmidt urged Washington to counter the peace movement by at least talking to the Russians. For almost a year, there was a deadlock in Washington as hardliners in the Pentagon, opposed to all arms control, fought with pragmatists in the State Department. But as European pressure mounted, officials in Washington began to look hard at a proposal Schmidt had been urging on the president.
We in Bonn started to try influencing them on the medium-range nuclear weapons negotiations. And we told them that, in our view, the best outcome would be 0-0, zero on either side.
In other words, zero SS-20s on the Russian side, zero Kruse or Pershings on NATO's. The zero option, unlike most arms control proposals, was easy to understand.
The president was attracted to the simplicity of the zero option and the fact that this would give him the initiative in the public diplomacy debate with the Soviets.
Deterring war...
In November 1981, after a big publicity buildup, President Reagan announced his proposal.
The United States is prepared to cancel its deployment of Pershing 2 and ground launch missiles if the Soviets will dismantle their SS-20, SS-4, and SS-5 missiles. This would be an historic step.
The zero option allowed Washington to seize the propaganda initiative, but it was a ploy. No one seriously expected the Soviets to exchange 400 missiles already in place for 570 that NATO had yet to deploy.
For mankind.
NATO did endorse collectively, Europeans as well as Americans, the zero-zero option. Most people, I think, endorsed it on the basis that it would not be negotiable.
I think, you see, it was nothing wrong, except that it was absolutely propagandistic. It was not a real proposal.
In December 1981, American and Soviet delegates met in Geneva to talk about the Reagan proposal. As expected, the Soviets at once rejected the zero option out of hand. They insisted that the SS-20 was already matched by British and French missiles and refused to accept any new American ones in Europe. Hopes of a compromise in Geneva soon evaporated. The spotlight moved to Moscow. At the end of 1982, Leonid Brezhnev finally lost his hold on life. He did not live to see the final act of the drama which, by accident or design, he had set in motion. That task would fall to his successor, Yuri Andropov. The deadline for NATO to deploy Kruse and Pershing, if negotiations failed, was fast approaching. Both sides realized that a failure to carry through that decision would be a major diplomatic defeat for NATO.
The political consequences of a failure would be catastrophic in the history of this alliance. And indeed, one could argue that the political consequences are far graver than the military consequences.
The double-track decision had plunged NATO into the worst political crisis in its history. Opposition to the missiles was no longer confined to peace groups like the women blockading Greenham Common Air Force Base in Britain. It had spread to major political parties. Helmut Schmidt fell from power in late 1982. Under other leaders, his party swung against the dual-track decision.
In a passionate speech, Mr. Brandt blamed the United States for causing the imminent failure of the Geneva talks. Deployment, he said, is against German and European interests alike.
The British Labour Party followed the same line.
Let's really make this party as something they can sell to the electorate. Peace! Peace! Peace!
We're not people who believe in peace at any price. We do not want the peace of Stalin. We want peace with freedom and justice.
The fate of the dual track rested now with two conservative leaders, Margaret Thatcher and Helmut Kohl.
The car's going to come up. The car's going to come up.
Both went to the polls in 1983, and the superpowers did their best to sway the voters.
The United States has modified its zero-option proposal for eliminating all medium-range nuclear missiles and has agreed to negotiate for something less than zero as a first step.
When it comes to intermediate nuclear missiles in Europe, it would be better to have none than to have some. But if there must be some, it is better to have few than to have many.
Andrei Gromyko was in a jovial mood this morning when he arrived to meet Chancellor Helmut Kohl. Later, at a rare press conference, he pulled out all the stops in his efforts to fuel local and widespread opposition here to nuclear missiles.
But the intervention of the Russians allowed Western governments to invoke the Red Menace.
How is Britain to be defended? Since 1940, the Soviet Empire has expanded, invading country after country too weak to resist her. The Labour Manifesto would gamble with Britain's defences by removing the nuclear deterrent that has kept the peace in Europe for almost 40 years.
You could understand why the Communist Manifesto wants to give Russia an easy ride. But why does Labour want to?
The political tide in Europe was turning to the right. Thatcher and Kohl both won their elections. But the battle to stop deployment continued on the streets and platforms of Europe throughout the fall. Finally, on the 15th of November, 1983, the missiles began to arrive in Britain.
I should inform the House that earlier today, the first cruise missiles were delivered by air.
The American Starlifter transport plane touched down just before 9 o'clock. Considering its significance, it was an event lacking in drama. A low loader emerged from the aircraft. On the trailer behind, concealed from the watching cameras, the cruise missiles. No one here will say how many, but a total of 16 are due to arrive over the next few weeks.
10 days later, the first Pershings came to Germany.
Arriving from the United States with fighter escorts, this C-5A transport touched down this afternoon at Ramstein Air Base in southwest Germany. The plane's presumed cargo, components of 9 Pershing II ballistic missiles. Under extremely heavy security, the cargo was transported by trucks to an undisclosed location where the Pershing IIs will be assembled, complete with their nuclear warheads.
That same day, the Soviet negotiators in Geneva walked out in protest.
Mr. Vitsinsky, can you tell us, did you walk out at all over?
No! Состоялось заседание. Мы в ходе этого заседания заявили...
During which we have stated...
...о прекращении нынешнего раунда переговоров.
...that the present round of the negotiations is discontinued...
...без установления какого-либо срока их возобновления.
...without any date set for their resumption.
For over a year, East and West seemed frozen in a new Cold War. But beneath the surface, forces were stirring which would transform the European missile confrontation. The Soviet Union was going through a prolonged succession crisis. One by one, the members of the Brezhnev generation made their melancholy journey to the Kremlin Wall. Andropov, Ustinov, Chernenko. But out of this process came a new Soviet leader, a mere 54 years old. Mikhail Gorbachev wasted no time in getting to work on Western leaders, trying to restart the process of negotiation. With his elegantly dressed wife, he launched a charm offensive to woo European public opinion. His confident handling of the Western media transformed the public image of the Soviet Union. With this new style came a new flexibility in arms control negotiations. Soon he could even accuse Washington of dragging its feet.
It's not enough to say, yes, we're in favor of a better world.
Пойдем по пути нормализации международной обстановки. Если это не подкрепляется, мы называем
by activities and deeds, we in the Soviet Union...
Behind this new urgency in Soviet policy lay a need to solve the problems of the Soviet economy and get speedy results in arms control.
This is tricking the people.
Gorbachev realized that the continuation of military competition, especially in nuclear matters, is without perspective. It is an investment of money, time, and intellect into something that could destroy Russians, Americans, and everyone on the planet. When the installation of the Pershing started in Europe, it became obvious that both sides can go too far. By this I mean there would be a significant buildup of missiles, increase in the number of warheads, decrease in the time necessary for the missiles to reach the target. It looks like the danger of nuclear war in Europe increased. The situation was quite worrisome. We had to find as quickly as possible a solution to the problem.
But there was a third factor. In March 1983, President Reagan had announced his strategic defense initiative. Star Wars was rapidly becoming the top item on the superpower agenda, and INF, missiles in Europe, were now chips in a bigger game. Star Wars was also part of another change in President Reagan himself. Now in his second term, hawkish rhetoric gave way to the language of the peace movement.
We seek the total elimination one day of nuclear weapons from the face of the earth. Nuclear arsenals are far too high, and our working relationship with the Soviet Union is not what it must be.
I don't think Ronald Reagan has ever been comfortable with nuclear weapons. And this notion of a nuclear-free world, which I think is rubbish, and dangerous rubbish at that, has always been present in his thinking. It just wasn't obvious to his supporters.
In November 1985, after 6 years of standoff, the leaders of the superpowers were finally talking again in Geneva.
They got to know each other. I don't think they produced very much in very concrete terms. But there was some principal agreements on a few very important issues. One of them, that you cannot win a nuclear war and you shouldn't fight a nuclear war.
Reagan and Gorbachev struck up an easy rapport, but converting the new mood into hard agreements was another matter. For almost a year afterwards, the Soviets and the Americans dangled proposals and counterproposals at each other. Gorbachev shifted his ground repeatedly. Sometimes he offered a deal on European missiles, INF, on their own. Sometimes he insisted that such a deal had to be coupled to one on space weapons as well. Either way, both sides would keep some missiles in Europe. It was the promise of a separate deal on INF, European missiles, that persuaded the Americans to agree to a hastily convened meeting at Reykjavik in Iceland. The Soviets had a surprise in store for Reagan.
We came to Reykjavik with simple, very concrete proposals. And this caught the Americans with their pants off. They thought that it will be some, you know, middle-of-the-road, very modest cosmetic proposal on INF.
Mr. President, what is the first topic that you think
you'll
discuss,
sir? The weather. Gorbachev sprung his surprise. He took up the old American zero-option proposal of 1981. The Russians would take out all their SS-20s if the U.S. took out Cruz and Pershing. Gorbachev had persuaded his military to accept losing the SS-20.
Спрашивается.
Why did we agree to adopt the zero option in 1985? Well, some changes in our political thinking had taken place. We also reassessed the balance of strategic forces in the world. We decided to disregard temporarily the nuclear arsenals of Britain and France, but only temporarily, and only in order to reach an agreement with the Americans.
But this was only the prelude. In 3 days of improvised negotiations, all the hallowed assumptions of nuclear strategy were thrown up in the air.
Well, what do you have to say this morning, Mr. President?
Good morning.
The high point was proposals to remove all ballistic missiles, perhaps even all nuclear weapons. Only President Reagan's refusal to give up on Star Wars prevented an agreement. The news of what had been talked about at Reykjavik sent a shockwave through NATO.
We now know that our fears of a U.S. president doing a deal over our heads was well-grounded. I mean, in fact, at Reykjavik, President Reagan agreed with General Secretary Gorbachev to eliminate all strategic ballistic missile systems, to negotiate them away without any reference to France or Britain. Which is fairly monstrous, quite honestly, since that was our deterrent.
The alliance strategy has been nuclear deterrence. And all of a sudden, the American leaders are talking about a world free of nuclear weapons. The abolition of, by our proposal, of all ballistic missiles. And an agreement, however tentative, to Mr. Gorbachev's proposal that we will get rid of all nuclear weapons. This without prior consultation with the Allies, who assumed that American leaders understood the basis of Western defense. It was a shattering blow.
Could the American president be trusted to look after his allies' interests? Mrs. Thatcher was the first of several anxious visitors to Washington seeking reassurance. President Reagan backtracked on many of his Reykjavik proposals. But one commitment made there proved impossible to wriggle out of, the zero option. A propaganda gambit designed to keep the peace movement quiet had now become NATO strategy.
We, NATO, invented it back in 81, thinking that the Russians would never be so quote-unquote stupid as to accept it. And suddenly there was a new Russian leader by the name of Gorbachev, who was, quote-unquote, stupid enough to accept it 6 years later. And at that point, it was very hard for Western governments to go back on something that they had been demanding for 6 years.
I heard a number of very senior political authorities and nations say, my God, how foolish we were to accept the zero-level option, you see. But how can they go back now to their people and say, whoops, we were wrong. We made a mistake.
The INF agreement was to remove these Soviet SS-20 missiles. In return, the U.S. would take out Cruz and Pershing. NATO thought that price was too high, that they'd lost weapons they saw as vital.
Zero-level LRINF will remove that one vital tool we have because it was the one that the Soviets saw the most painful, a tool which we had decided in 1979 we had to have to fill the gap in our spectrum of deterrent, irrespective of the SS-20 coming along. That just made it more urgent for us to make the right decision and to get on with it.
And NATO commanders had another worry, that with all the long-range missiles withdrawn from Europe, the Soviets would still have in place some shorter-range missiles, to which NATO would have no counter. The American Secretary of State, George Shultz, raised this question with Gorbachev. But at a meeting in the Kremlin in April 1987, Gorbachev simply offered to take those away as well. It was a daring offer, unprecedented in the nuclear age. It meant that the Soviets were now prepared to withdraw considerably more missiles than NATO. This put enormous pressure on NATO to agree, but it emphasized Soviet superiority in conventional forces and chemical weapons. Mrs. Thatcher and Chancellor Kohl had put themselves on the line to get Cruz and Pershing into their countries. Both would have preferred to hang on to some. But Mrs. Thatcher had an election coming. She couldn't afford to oppose an agreement that would reduce nuclear weapons. Chancellor Kohl was left on his own and had no option but to fall in line.
The British government, the French government, and all the other governments we asked for support let us down. And there's a bitter feeling that we see now that you are in a much better position as far as your security is concerned than our country.
The Germans were especially unhappy. Most of the nuclear weapons left in Europe would now be short-range artillery and missiles based in or destined to explode in Germany. Their allies, with nuclear weapons of their own, would not be exposed to such risks.
The French and the British, on the other hand, are not too worried, providing the nuclear weapons are there, and in their view, they think the Russians were unlikely to risk anything so long as nuclear weapons are likely to go off. So that, in a way, this issue is splitting Western Europe between Germany and France and Britain. The other thing, of course, is the French and British governments are terrified that if the movement towards nuclear disarmament in Europe goes any further, then their own strategic forces are bound to be under pressure.
The Europeans are almost totally schizophrenic. There's almost no way to please them. If you're getting along with the Russians, they worry that European interests are being sold out. If you're not getting along with the Russians, they think that there's going to be nuclear war.
On December 8, 1987, the United States and the Soviet Union signed the historic INF Treaty.
It's an historic day, actually. Maybe it will be remembered.
It's a marvelous Christmas present, just an extra piece of goodwill and a lovely way to end the year.
So wie Atomwaffen unter 500 Kilometer Reichweite.
Western European leaders try to hide their doubts.
Nuclear weapons left in the world, $1 trillion a year spent on weapons. We've got a long way to go before we build a world where war is seen to be a barbaric way of settling people's differences.
Only after they really saw that they couldn't talk us out of it, con us out of it, bluff us out of it, produce peace movements and freeze movements and so forth to put on political pressure, all that failed, that they then came around to negotiate.
I think that Mr. Gorbachev and Mr. Reagan could never have brought it about if there had not been the climate that has been created by the peace movement.
The military situation thereafter will be very similar to the military situation with which we have rather comfortably lived until 1977.
After a decade of chaos and confusion, no harm was done.
This program was produced by WGBH Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. Major funding for war and peace in the nuclear age was provided by the Annenberg CPB Project. Additional funding was provided by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies for over 100 years, providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. And by the W. Walton Jones Foundation, the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, public television stations, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. War and Peace in the Nuclear Age is a college course with textbooks published by Alfred A. Knopf. For information about the television course and related video cassettes, books, and off-air taping rights, call the Annenberg CPB Project at 1-800-LEARNER. The companion book to War and Peace in the Nuclear Age is now available, written by John Newhouse and published by Alfred A. Knopf. The 512-page hardcover can be ordered by calling 1-800-441-3000, $24.95 plus handling. Please have your credit card ready. What are nuclear missiles for?
The idea is not to kill all the people in a given nation, but to render that nation unable to continue the war.
MX was not a defensive weapon. It was a first strike weapon.
The clash of ideas in the making of the MX missile, next time on War and Peace in the Nuclear Age.